Hello, everyone. Right, I got to get used to this new StreamYard technology. They've updated it. We're supposed to be doing it at some point in the next couple of months, Feisty Witches, and I am completely reliant on all of this technology to work. That means getting people to come in for interviews, overlaying graphics, all that clever technical crap. But I used to be very good at many years ago. It all seems to be quite complicated now, overly complicated. So I'm producing this a mini crap series, all to do with books like this, so that I can get used to this, get used to working it and all that stuff, all the technical stuff. And also, because I'm not allowed to do book reviews anymore, because my book reviews are apparently crap, I figured I could almost marry the two up. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a little series. There's not going to be a book review because there aren't any book reviews, but I'm going to talk about books because, as you probably all know, I can't stand books. I own quite a few books and I've read quite a few books, more than 10 in my life, right? But when it comes to books, there's a couple of pet hates and things like that. One of my pet hates is when people post online and Facebook and stuff, would you recommend this book? Should I get this book? I don't know. I don't even know you. How am I supposed to know whether it's going to be an interesting book for you? So instead of talking about that, I think that I'm just going to take a couple of books that I may like or dislike, and I'm just going to tell you what I got from them. So the first one that we're getting is The Book of English Magic, okay, which is quite cool. I quite liked this book, but it isn't one of those things where you're going to learn a lot from. Now, I think with occultism and magic, because this is a book of magic, supposedly, English magic, British magic, I would probably say, people expect to be told everything. People expect to, much like school, you learn, memorize, and then regurgitate. And I think this book for me was quite interesting because there is, on the face of it, a lot of things that you could potentially memorize and regurgitate. It's very heavy on talking about practitioners. And the good thing about talking about practitioners is that you get a sense of personality and the fact that we're all different. You don't get the dogmatic approach of that you do seem to get, I think, with occultism, is we all do this, we all believe in this, we all practice this way, harm none, love spells are bad type situation. Whereas with books like this, I've seen things like this come about before, particularly when it comes to cunning folk in the cunning arts, and they tend to focus on history and a little bit about practitioners, and normally it's legends and stuff like that, like Old Mother Shipton, who is mentioned in here. But it does give you a sense that actually there's a character behind the magic, you know? You get a real sense of someone's personality, right? The other good thing about this book is that it's got real life people in it. So it has the legends of people that are kind of, yeah, they were around, most of them, but at the same time, how many of those stories of their uberly cool powers and what they used to get up to and stuff is realistically actually accurate. This actually tells little snippets about modern practitioners for the 20th and 21st century, people you could actually go and meet today because they're still alive, a few of them. But with books like this, I kind of feel like, again, there's something missing because when I read about a cunning folk book in the cunning folk books, it says, oh, the old seven shares, the old book and key, divination, find out who's stolen your sheep or whatever, but it doesn't really tell you how the magic works. That so much of that is missing. And I think people that gravitate towards a lot of these sorts of books want to know how the magic works. They don't just want a book of stories. What they want is they want to go to be able to start tinkering and dabbling with magic. And although you could say it's possibly not a good idea to dabble with magic, realistically, that's where we start. We start with dabbling and tinkering and having a little play about. And I think this book does good in the form that it actually sets tasks for you to go and do. And it doesn't set you those stupid tasks of go and do this. Well, actually, that's not true, it does. We'll get to the love spell in a bit. But at the end of each chapter, There is a places to visit, okay, or a things to do. And I like that because it talks a little bit about the history. And I'll probably point out a couple of these as we go along. Points out a little bit of history and stuff like that. But then it says, well, why don't you go and visit this place? Why don't you go and do this thing? And I quite like that. And I think that magic and practitioners are quite disjointed. I suppose, always have been to a certain extent. But these days, when you look at the ways we have to communicate, when we look at social media and those sorts of things in particular, the content that we're producing, the stuff that we're posting, is pretty crap. I mean, come on. I mean, this book, which is something that I've actually tried to do, is to go to one or two of these places. And I know that for the mundanes that take this book, they don't think that anything's realistically, it's just going to be basically little holiday spots around England, really. But I find that when you mirror actual magical practitioners' practices, particularly the traditional sort, and you see what they get up to on their weekends and their days off, they're all visiting places in this book, you know? They're all doing little bits and pieces, little projects and things like that. And I think, does this book kind of trick you into meeting others or trick you into kind of doing the work? Because there is a quote in this book, and it's actually by a very, very famous witch. I don't know if I should do that. Should I do that right now? I don't know. We might have to go, we'll go through the book logically. But it makes a very good point. So before I go to that, let's start at the very fucking beginning and let's go from the first chapter that I've highlighted. So the first chapter is interesting. It talks a little bit about places. Now, one of the places it talks about is Silbury Hill and Long Barrow here, which is somewhere that I visited. Okay, so when I talked about this book telling you to go and visit places, at the end of that chapter, it actually says, why don't you go and visit this place, that place, and the other? And we have this thing in Bristol at the Tuesday night moot called Moot on the Move, where we just meet up in various places and go round and walk around. And you've got magical people meeting up at very magical places. And we all talk about things. What do you see? What do you sense? What feelings do you get? Have you ever been this here before? Have you ever done rituals before? What's your interest in this? That's where I think knowledge gets passed practically, not through books. Now, this book, you could say, is bad because it doesn't give a huge amount of of information about these things. It tells you where they are, and it talks a little bit about like history, long barriers, and that kind of thing, which is kind of interesting. But at the same time, you could Google it. What it doesn't really give you is why you're going there, and I think these books are supposed to appeal to certain people that will go to those places, and when they get there, that is almost like their initiation. They might buy this book, they might read a load of stuff, might find it quite interesting, but then they might go there. And when they go to, I don't know, the White Horse at Uffington, which is another place I've visited, that one, then they might get a sense of feeling. You know, they might be intrigued. Maybe spirits or something like that might appear to them or rub off on them in some respect. I kind of see that with the National Trusty English Heritage Ramblers. They wander about from sacred site to sacred site and all this kind of thing, which is quite interesting. Many people don't get any further than that, but I have known quite a few people that join National Trust or English Heritage, go on the Ramblers thing, and then actually they have some kind of an experience where they feel a certain thing, and that is the bit, the kind of catalyst that gets the ball rolling on the whole occultism thing. This in particular one, I'll show you. So this one here, if we say, yep. I actually visited with the Moot on the Move. There we go. I don't know if you can still hear me when I'm doing this, but this is a little video I took from it. There's a long barrel, okay? And you have to think, places like this, why do people visit places like this? Because I was sat with a group of witches and we were kind of all talking. I wouldn't say they were all witches, but a lot of them were witches. And we were all chatting a bit about that, and slowly but surely, one by one, we kind of noticed that there are the ramblers that come along because there's an official footpath and people want to go out for a nice afternoon walk, that sort of thing. But then there are also the people, neo-pagans, I'll say, that come with their little incense sticks and plant little incense sticks in there. And you kind of think, what are they doing? They're paying their respects, presumably, or much like the tree a little bit further down the road, maybe tying ribbons and asking for witches and stuff like that. That kind of neo-pagan petition-based make a wish upon a star magic. There's a quote in there somewhere. Quite like that. Neo-pagan make a wish upon a star magic. It's just short for neo-pagan. But ultimately, I think that you're supposed to get a little bit more from that. You know, I tend to get a little bit more from that. I tend to withdraw a little bit, even if I go out on with groups and stuff like that. There's a lot of energies that are either on these places. I mean, this one here, actually opposite, the little woods opposite, which no one goes. There's a lot more energy in there than this kind of little long barrel. And I didn't actually take any pictures, I don't think, or if I did, they're not on my computer. But with that kind of thing, it's like, it's very interesting. A lot of these neo-pagans, like, they do retain a certain energy. But I think because a lot of them are, they're on the tour, I suppose. And because they're visited by a lot of people, actually a lot of actual true serious magical practice takes place nearby, but not quite on the land. So opposite to that, there was quite an interesting little woodland area that was, I don't know, I'd say holding a certain energy. I might have to ask Our Lady Poison, because she was on the little group when we wandered around there. So when we interview her next, I might have to ask her about that. Anyway, so the next thing focusing on here was ley lines. Now with this, they're talking a lot about ley lines because of the whole kind of, well, let's be fair, England ley lines. There's loads of interest in that. It's all kind of metaphysical and uberly apparently cool. I don't find ley lines particularly cool. But what I disliked about this is that it talks about ley lines and going and hunting for ley lines and the equipment you need to go and do it. And all of it involves getting a map, a ruler, and a pencil, and getting sacred sites, and then seeing how many of them line up. This is why ley lines, I don't think, are really utilised very efficiently or even at all with modern magical practice, because of this approach is the approach of theoretically someone says there's energy currents between buildings. I suppose if I got a pencil and a ruler and a map, I'd be able to find those energy currents. This is so not my cup of tea, this kind of idea of practice, because for me, when I teach and when I mentor, what I tend to find is energies appear or even scream out to a certain extent towards people. And not all energies come to everyone, but everyone picks up on certain energies, or everyone will pick up on a certain energy, right? And I think with the hunt for ley lines and stuff like that, what I don't think what we should be doing is the theory of working out where there should be ley lines. I think what we should really be doing is getting out more and actually seeing there's an energy in this place. There's a flow of something here. And I think that a lot of the real cool ones get missed out for the simple reason that they're not on maps. I mean, me and Chris did a little podcast about some things like this. A lay of the land, I think it was called, about energy currents moving and obstacles being placed in the way, and a lot of energy currents, you know, because there aren't buildings on them anymore, just being forgotten because they go through some forest. And really, I think that if you really want to start looking at ley lines, you're talking about looking at energy currents and the flow of energy. And I think you don't need a map and a pencil to do that. You need to go out and start feeling when you are noting down when you feel energy. Even if you just went out to a bunch of, so say, sacred sites, and felt, do I feel anything here, and cross them off with a no, don't feel anything here. What about Silbury? No, don't feel anything here. Okay, West Kennet Long Way? No, don't feel anything there. Okay, Avery Stone Circle? Oh yes, I feel something here. And just ticking them I've got so many people to do that. They don't really think to do that because the books never tell you to. But you'll get more from that because out of the massive list of, so say, sacred sites and haunted places and stuff like that, you'll have a list shortened down to places where you actually feel something. And when you feel something, then go and work with the things that you feel, right? And then when you feel those energies, try and ask yourself a little bit different, a little bit more. How far does this energy extend from this area? Is it confined to this sacred site? This long barrow that we were talking about, that it feels to me is almost like an island. I mean, there's a pathway, walkway, and then you have to go over or through a gate, and then there's kind of in the corner a field which is surrounded by trees. So it does kind of almost feel like an enclosed island space. Same with the bit across the other side, which was just the forest that retained energy. There's little pockets of energy in a lot of these places. And feel where's the energy come from? Is it just here in the air? Is it coming from a certain direction? Is it flowing in a certain direction? A lot of the time, energy does tend to flow. If it's not a pocket of energy, it will flow. The flowing of energy is, generally speaking, where you'd find a ley line, because ley lines, flowing of energy. I'll skip the next bit because that's a boring bit. There's an interesting part here where it talks a little bit about druids and all of that kind of thing, and the druid revival and stuff like that, magical practice. And okay, modern druid revival isn't for me. Traditional witchcraft, probably not so much for me. Wicca, definitely not for me. Cunning folk practices, inspired by, but realistically, I don't think I've ever used the seven shears, not in this life. Magical practice as a system. The whole druid thing, spirituality, really the idea of either tapping into something ancient or trying to learn the secrets of ancients that are long since dead. Most of the great occult lodges, magical systems and stuff have what I'd say is bullshit beginnings, fake beginnings, whether it be Wicca with Gerald Garner pretending that he got initiated by a bunch of random witches, or whether it be Druidism or anything like that. A lot of these have kind of bullshit origin stories, which are proven to be academically false. But it doesn't really matter because it gives people a sense, a cohesive kind of practice to expand and go along. What I dislike about a lot of these, though, is they get stuck with trying to recreate what went before. And when you recreate what went before, one thing you have to realize is that you're not going to get there. You're not going to get the full practice. You are going to be the Neo and Neo-Pagan. New version, a different version of that, that is realistically nothing like what came before. And you really have to ask yourself at that point, what is the purpose? What's the purpose of my system, religion, thing? What is it? Because if it's magical practice and pushing yourself in some form of progression or evolution of your practice, then you need to be pushing further. So although that may be a platform, stepping stones for you to jump upon, I think too much of the time it becomes a limiting factor, because you're really a lot of the time just learning and basing your practices on things that you believe or someone's basically told you have come before, learning those. I mean, later on it does talk a little bit about runes and stuff like that. I'm not going to talk about runes today. I think I did highlight the page, but I mean, it does talk about in this book a little about runes and how you shouldn't really be going and memorizing a bunch of rune charts. This rune equals this. This rune means that sort of thing, which I agree with. It does talk specifically about going out and specifically finding rune or opening a rune up and asking it to tell you what it's about through visions or cropping up in your life. I understand that and I agree with that, because that would be the approach that I would probably take. As I believe Will says, if you want to get to know a rune, then go and get to know a fucking tree. Unfortunately, it may be all well and good saying that in this book, which it does, but then it goes and gives a chart. It literally then on the following page after saying, well, you know, some people like to go and do this. Some people like to ask the rune or try to conjure up the spirit of the rune or, you know, this kind of thing. But then when it does that on the following page, it proceeds to give you a correspondence chart of these are the runes, these are the names, and these are what they do. And it doesn't seem right to me. You know, because I see so many people, and you could argue, well, the people that are really on a magical path, they'll ignore that. But I mean, what are you really getting from putting that in there? I think it kind of is almost like saying smoking's bad for you, and then immediately lighting up a cigarette and smoking in front of the person you've just told you, you know, you've just tried to persuade not to smoke. It's kind of like, I don't know. Anyway. Next section talks a little bit about, in the Anglo-Saxon magic section, the nine herbs charm. This is very interesting. Not so much the nine herbs charm, but what they've talked about, because they've said something very specific. And it gives you a charm that you're supposed to say out loud. And it gives you several herbs supposedly used by the Anglo-Saxons for medicine and magic. And it actually says, I'm going to try and find it. The nine herbs charm was used to treat wounds and nine different poisons or infections. It begins powerfully and mysteriously, addressing each of the nine herbs directly. Right. This is what I believe they should put in this section. They should also put this section in, they've got a charm and spell section, right? This is a little bit of information for you. That is another pet hate of mine. Most of the time, in fact, yeah, most of the time, people's charms and spells and things like that don't work. I'm going to say that, right? I'm going to say most people cannot do spell casting. The people that can pick up a book, read a spell, right, and then it work, tend to be those sorts of natural magical practitioners that do accidental magic all of the time. Reason being, because they are attached to energy, energy of emotions, words, all that sort of thing, and they accidentally make magic happen. So as soon as you give someone a structure like a charm or something like that to focus on, they tend to be able to use that very often as a structure to allow that energy to release and to leave them in a structured way with an intention behind it, with a journey, with all of the things that it takes to make spells actually work. A lot of the people don't have that. A lot of people don't have the natural ability to be able to just manipulate energy, often accidentally, but besides the point, the natural witches. A lot of people in the world ain't natural witches, right? Natural witches have to learn to understand the ability that they have to control it. Non-natural witches are people that need to understand how to pull that energy out in the first place. The natural witches, they have an abundance of that energy, so much so that it leaks out and causes untold devastation a lot of the time, particularly when attached to emotions. Whereas the others, the unnaturals, they need to find and activate and be able to pull that energy out, the spell, when they're using their own magic to cast spells and stuff like that, make stuff happen. Now, in this book, it does say to address each ingredient of the spell, let's say. It was a nine herbs charm, so you're addressing each of the nine herbs. One thing that they don't say, which I think I would like to point out, because I think it's important, addressing an ingredient, whether it's a herb or what, it doesn't fucking matter, but in dressing it, that does not mean that you just name it. There's the idea of plant spirit allies and all of that kind of thing. The idea that, well, actually, everything's alive. All of these trees and plants and things, they're alive. A lot of people think, well, yeah, I know they're alive. They're plants and trees. They're living things. Realistically, most people feel they're alive because they've been told in biology, in science at school, these things are alive. The rocks are not alive. See the difference? They growl. The rocks don't really growl. They crumble and stuff. Really understanding what it truly means by everything is alive is understanding and be able to see it for its personality and its type. When you address anything in a spell, anything in a charm, you are not petitioning, really. People will say, please do this for me, to gods and spirits and the like. And a lot of the time that transfers over to plants as well, plant spirit allies. Please do this for me. When you're addressing an ingredient in a charm, particularly ancient ones and old ones, you're addressing something that you should have worked with before. Okay. When I sit around a boardroom in a big company, and I'm the managing director, for example, or the CEO, I'm addressing the executive of the finance department, the head of HR, this person, that person, head of operations. I'm addressing people that, right? And when you do that, I already have an existing relationship with those people, okay? I've already got an existing relationship. When you get a charm like this, Nine Herbs Charm, if you're doing it for the first time and you've randomly bought all of these ingredients from a shop, like Thoth Witchcraft Shop or Sons of Asgard or something like that, you have no real working relationship with these. What you need to do before you start using them for spells, I personally say, and many of our patrons would notice this because we get you to work with ingredients before you start working with ingredients, is to actually get to know them, to get to know their personalities, to essentially invoke or evoke them, to understand the spirit behind it. Okay, get to know each of the energies, get to know their personality. The personality will reveal so much about what that can do and whether you can fucking trust it or not. Because just because it's a plant and you've bought it and you've put it in a jar, don't mean that it's trustworthy. Don't mean that it's even capable of doing the thing that you're asking it to do. So my suggestion is that you get to know the plants, and I don't mean buying a herbal and memorizing where does the plant grow. I mean, if you do not have the ability to speak to the plant or plants or ingredients, or summon up the energy, feel the energy, have an actual conversation with it, then you shouldn't be bloody reading out a charm from a book and expecting it to fucking work, because it probably won't. I'm going to cover that in a lot more detail later on. Not in this, because we are running out of time, but a lot of people really don't get that approach. They don't get the idea of actually, if you have a project and you are sat around the boardroom and you have all of these experts in their fields and heads of departments, there's relationship there and everyone knows their job roles first. You know their job roles first. They know their job roles. You're coming together for a project. A spell is a project. A magical ritual is a project. All of these things, they're projects. Okay, but you shouldn't realistically, or you do, if you do, at any rate, just involve some random unknown into your spell work, and you have to kind of understand that there's big potential for things to go wrong. Now, does that mean that you cannot start using an ingredient for the first time in a spell? No, that doesn't mean that you can't do that. But what you do need to make sure that you're doing is you're getting to know that ingredient whilst doing that spell. Okay. When I did the triple binding spell, you'll notice that I actually interacted with the ingredients and asked them what to do. All of those ingredients I'd used before. We have a working relationship. I understand them. If I hadn't had a working relationship, but I was still drawn towards a specific ingredient, then I would have to evolve the get to know you process in that spell, which would have made the spell longer. Yeah, that 1 hour video could have potentially taken 8 hours because realistically, you're getting to know a person, you're getting to know a personality. I'm going to leave that there because it sometimes goes over the heads of some people. What's this? The Web of Weird, something Paul talks about. I can't even remember why I bookmarked that one. A basic premise of the magical worldview is that most people go through life oblivious of the magic that is all around them, like the muggles of J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter. Learning magic involves developing a curiosity about the world, particularly about nature and about history, so that its secrets can be revealed in all their wonder, like an alchemist finding gold. Important. Magical practice is about, to a certain extent, realistically, you gaining power over the world. Okay, when we learn spells and charms and things like that, we learn how to do healings and hexes and that. That's us deciding to force our will upon the world. I don't like the fact that person's sick. I like that person. I want them to get better. I'm going to make them better. That's a witch, right? That isn't someone that's like, oh, well, yeah, I suppose I'll pray to the goddess, and the goddess, if she thinks it's good, she'll do it. No, witchcraft and magic, from my perspective, is always about you asserting your will upon the world. You standing is about sovereignty. And I'm not saying becoming some kind of tyrannical dictator and trying to take over the world or anything like that. Magic is about you understanding the mysteries, and through understanding those mysteries, either gaining the ability to change things or developing an understanding of something so that you don't have to change something. Mysteries are mysteries, it's something that you don't know. Death is important, extremely important. You don't necessarily need to overcome death in the sense of learning magic to be able to live forever and ever and ever. You know, some people embark on that journey and study necromancy in particular and the healing arts in order because they're scared of death. But actually, although going down that route and working with Saturn and learning the Saturnian current and what it's all about and gaining a certain amount of power from it will help you perhaps change death or hold it off or anything like that. It also teaches you the necessity of it, why it exists. Okay, I'm just going to leave that one there. Oh, what's this one? I've drawn a line under this, so this must be important. The Book of Runes, blah, blah, blah. Oh, yeah, this was the thing I was talking about, runes. Interpretation intuitively, blah, 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 blah. One by one, he took each stone in his hand and meditated on its meaning, writing down what came to him. Some people will notice that we've got them to do that with planetary energies and stuff like that, where we actually, Chris had a whole soap opera thing going on about it once, whereas actually, I need to get to know these planets a little bit more. So he actually invited them in, the energies, tried to do a little something. And what happens, which is something that, again, I'm not too sure how many people actually mention this. When you don't have a huge amount of psychic ability and you connect to a current that has a large amount of sentience and energy and ability to affect things, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to suddenly appear in front of you. What it means is when you open that door, it is possibly going to come through and start interfering with your life in such a way that it teaches you lessons, whether that's coming and showing you signs and omens, whether that is coming and appearing to you in dreams, whereas that's setting you up into certain situations where you learn things. A lot of that is realistically how most magical practitioners learn an energy current, particularly a personified one. The seven planetary mysteries, a lot of people that invite them in and start working with them don't necessarily always get Zeus appearing to them in the middle of their living room whilst they're fully awake. What they will get is they will get a more Jupiterian presence in their life. Things come up which they then start to notice, which they then start to feel, to taste, to understand. And then that tends to escalate more and more and more. Obviously, psychic ability does increase. But there we go. Okay, so we've got a whole spellcrafting section in this book, right? And there's a one I've underlined, which is an interesting point. Because they do talk about being a Christian represented no barrier to the use of spells. Many cunning folk were Christians in the sense that cultural Christianity being the dominant religion at this time, you know, during kind of medieval periods onwards, which was when we're talking English magic at this point, that you could marry up Christianity in magical practice. So here's an interesting one. Let the cross of Christ bring it back. The cross of Christ, which was lost by the theft, was found again. Let Abraham close to you paths, roads, hills, and rivers. Let Job bring him, the thief, bound to judgment. So this is a spell, okay? Whether it potentially is a quote from the Bible, but as we all know, the Bible makes for quite a great spell book if you're Christian. Now, here's the difference, okay, that I see with... When you are using your own energy, that energy needs to be raised within you and released. And I did a little video about, I think it was a war charm or something like that, teaching the basic technique of this for people to practice. And you don't necessarily need to use the Bible and stuff like that as the sole petition base, asking a spirit in a prayer. Oh, well, Jesus, please do this for me. I'm using your words. There are many ways to use the Bible as a spell book. One is as a petition-based spell work prayer, saying, please, angels, Holy Mary, Mother of whatever the fuck, do this for me, please. But only if it's good, only if you see it as a good thing, you know. Curse my enemies, but if it's bad, then please don't curse them and please forgive me for asking you to do that type situation, right? Other people use what is often referred to as spiritual authority. I think I did a video on this on the Thoth TV YouTube channel, so you'll have to have a little look there. But I'm pretty sure I did scriptural authority or something like that, which is, okay, these words carry a certain amount of energy and power to them. Okay, the rainbow is apparently a covenant pact of God, and we understand that it's supposed to stop the world from flooding and stuff. It's an omen. So if I made a sigil of a rainbow and pointed it at the sky whilst it's raining, does that mean it will stop the rain? Biblical magic. Potentially that is biblical magic. I've seen that done. In fact, I've done that before. It was one of the first things I did when I was younger. The other idea is the idea of bending the words. Okay, so is that poetry, songs, anything like that, if it evokes within you and helps you channel that energy within you, like an angry pastor shouting that you're all a bunch of sinners, then, you know, is one of those things that you've got to think, well, okay, the words come from the Bible, but at the same time, you know? I think I'll have to do a video on that at some point in the future. So, oh dear, look at this one. How to perform a love spell. I was hoping for something good in this book because it's got quite a lot of interesting stuff in, quite a lot of good stuff, a little bit of occult knowledge. But then it kind of ruins it because it says basically to do a love spell, you need to go and get a green candle. To cast this spell, you need a single green candle and some pure olive oil or aromatherapy oil. Some practitioners like to write their spell on the candle or to carve symbols. So we all know this. You can go on Instagram, Facebook, all of these various different places. And let's be fair, all you'll see is this. The physical things, colour correspondences, all of that sort of thing. And it irks me, if that's a word. I find it a little annoying because, again, from how I've mentioned earlier, so many people can't make magic work and spell work work. They love the stuff they produce that is beautiful, making that nice little pretty jar spell or carving that candle. They love it, and they put energy invested into the fact that it's a beautiful piece and they like it, and they really, really, really want the thing to happen. But they miss out on the fact that most of the magic there is accidental. People say it's all about the intention, but it ain't all about the intention at all. We know that. Because when mummy's at the side of little Timmy's bed and he's a dying in hospital, and she's just saying, I really, really, really want little Timmy to get better, and little Timmy dies, there was intention for him to get better, and yet it still didn't happen, did it? He still died. So why is that? Well, obviously, there's a lot more going on than just the intention. As anyone that knows who's been a patron of ours, and we've started to teach in basic spellcasting, or maybe even some of the people that have taken the basic spellcasting video course on our Thoth TV YouTube channel might know. But there we go. Intention is not all about the intention. Spells, remember the whole spell triangle thing. Now, this is really, really good, okay? This is an area of magic that I'm not really that great at. Alchemy. I'm getting more and more and more into alchemy, I have to say. But mainly, I didn't really start with alchemy. I started with the theory and practice of ceremonial magic within my way of dealing with it, simply for the reason that I like all my ducks in a row, and alchemy is a very expensive project. So I'm getting more into alchemy. I've spent many a late night at the pub chatting to our friend Lady Poison, who's a lot better at the whole herbal alchemy than I am, but maybe she'll give me a few lessons. One thing that I am going to start experimenting with is what I call alchemical tinctures, which are spagerics. So the idea within herbal alchemy is basically that you are taking the parts of plants and things, separating them all, energizing them all individually, working with them all individually, and then combining them together again. Now, this is quite interesting because when it goes to the ancient perspective and tribal perspectives, you need to kind of think about, well, actually, they wouldn't really do all of this gathering stuff up and putting it in a jar. They would go and take fresh plants and only really work with the fresh plants. If you're a tribe living in a jungle or something like that, right, it's really going to be fresh. They didn't really have all these beautifully pretty kilner jars, right, that we have. With the medieval period onwards, that kind of thing, even from the ancient world, Egyptians and all that sort of Mesopotamians and stuff, they had quite sophisticated herbal magics and healings and stuff like that. This is quite an interest of mine, because, again, I like structure, but also because it's a mystery. The whole thing's a mystery, and I do love a mystery, and I like to make sense of mysteries and put them all cleanly. A mystery for me, and alchemy for me, is like someone passing you the Christmas lights that are supposed to go on the tree and saying, Liam, you're good at untangling these. It happens every year. They're all knotted up. Can you just spend an hour trying to untangle them? Because I ain't got the patience for it. That, to me, is what alchemy is. Is it the only form of magical practice? No. It is a magical practice that is literally a headache. It is a puzzle. And it is kept a puzzle. It's kept secret. I'm probably going to put a little bit more alchemical content out there. In fact, in this book, it does give, I'm sure I bookmarked it. Oh, I don't think I did bookmark it. That's a shame. There's a formula for making, there it is. How to make the Philosopher's Stone. I'm going to make the Philosopher's Stone. And it tells you all you need in order to make the Philosopher's Stone. So I'm going to have a go at making a Philosopher's Stone, and I'll put it in the Witchcraft Live Facebook group, no doubt. Apparently, to create the stone, you will need enough dried lemon balm, a Melissa officinalis, to fill a bottling jar, a third full, but when reduced to a powder, so you need to reduce it to a powder, and then fill it a third full. And then you need brandy or vodka, I'll be using vodka. And mortar and pestle, funnel, you know, cheesecloth, oven gloves. The usual stuff. I'm going to give it a go of taking what this book says on how you make the Philosopher's Stone, and I am going to make it the way they tell me to make it. I'm going to see if it works, and I'm going to see what I gain from it. I thought it might be quite fun to do that as a little project. I have an idea of what I might gain from it, and it's not a work I would normally do, so I'm extra excited. Next section, toad doctors, charmers, and girdle measures. Cunning folk were usually in command of a range of methods and offered their services for a variety of ends. I love on this page, fortune tellers were on the lowest rung of the ladder of the magical practitioners. So true. Psychics are shit. I mean, the vast majority of professional psychics out there couldn't magic their way out of a paper bag. They really, really well and truly are on the bottom rung, the lowest rung of the ladder, right? Magical practitioners, cunning folk. Cunning folk are problem solvers. When you solve a problem, you learn a hell of a lot because it's all headaches and mysteries and stuff like that. Okay, that's why I quite like the cunning folk arts and gravitated towards that. Because even if you are doing the same type of work, maybe you just specialized in love, maybe you just specialized in lost property, maybe you just specialized in kicking other witches' asses, you're going to learn a lot and it's always going to be fresh and interesting because every story is different, every approach is different. These people that just do the same thing over and over again, religious forms of magic. Wiccan, some of the ceremonial magicians, same old rhetoric over and over again. Oh, I just do it this way because it's always been done that way. Oh, okay, no, I don't like it. But yeah, cunning folk are cool. Cunning folk are awesome, and I'm not just saying that because apparently I'm a cunning man. Although I am just saying that because I'm a cunning man. Apparently, does one call themselves a cunning man? Yes, one does because one starts up shop. A little upstart that wants to make money out of magic, you're a cunning man. Star lore and herb craft, high magic versus low magic. Oh, high magic versus low magic. Well, we all know about that one. When giving healing, the cunning person would often combine herbal remedies. Herbal remedies with prayers or charms. Yes. Okay. Science. Yeah. Psychology. Yeah. And magic. All of those three, I believe, should be put into a cunning man or woman's practices. Okay. When you do work for a client, you can make spells and stuff, interact with them, and work on an energetic level. That's a magical bit. A psychological level. That's getting in their fucking head. And a physiological level. That's affecting the body. When I do healing work in particular, I won't just be reliant on medications and herbal remedies that have a physiological effect on the body. I will also incorporate psychological things in that and magical things. Some people within the magical community just use one of the three of those, some combine two. Rarely do I see in this day and age people utilizing all three of them. When you look at the really ancient, and I'm talking Mesopotamian and Egyptian and all that sort of stuff, they went for all three. They made sure they had all three of those in a good healing charm or healing practice or ritual or something. All of those really go deeper into the psychology and the psychology of programming the mind and stuff like that, because it will help you. Okay. So the greatest magician, or who I believe to be the greatest magician alive in this day, the greatest magician of the age, someone that I've actually personally met, actually worked as a strongman and does circus strongman stuff. And he's really great in magic for the simple reason that he actually does hypnosis. Okay. And you have to hypnotize yourself to be able to push past certain limits. And when you're able to hypnotize yourself and understand your own mind, you unlock so much power there and so much ability for you to wield more and more and more and more. There's a reason why within our Patreon system that we make sure that everyone is undergoing. Oh, well, that's interesting because the next chapter is about the risks of the magical path. Fascinating. I think I will probably end on this because we're going to be out of time otherwise. So, One thing that I'd like to talk about, actually, just briefly, because it does come up with the risks of magical path. We are one of those rare mentors which actually take on people with complex mental health issues. A lot of the time, much like some of the people in this book recommend, don't go near a mental person with a barge pole. Don't teach them magic. From my perspective, I have met so many magical practitioners that are fucking off their rocker. They're crazy. And they're crazy because of that access to magic. They're crazy because of the magic, a lot of them. They also have had very bad pasts, some of them, not all of them, but some of them have had very bad pasts. I cannot condone pushing people away because of mental health issues. Okay. I've personally mentored many people that other practitioners would say, I'm not teaching their magic, them magic, they're too unstable. Whereas I see something very different. I see magic being something that can be used to help someone with some of their psychological problems and past issues and stuff like that. That being said, a magical path, in order for you to progress, one cannot cheat past a certain level. You can cheat with regards to these stupid witchcraft diplomas where you regurgitate information and pass a multiple choice exam. You can cheat when it comes to initiation practices because, again, most initiations are bullshit. I will do a something on initiations, I think, at some point, because I'll show you a little bit about initiations that I would condone. They're a lot different than the ones I'm seeing a lot of the time. But with regards to the magical journey, you will either, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, is not really how it works. You will either die or you will become an extremely strong individual. Okay, within the magical path is you keep progressing and progressing and progressing. And I mean, keep going and not just stop and say, okay, I'm happy at this point. I mean, keep going. You are constantly biting off more and more and more and more and more. And when you bite off more than you can chew, you choke every now and then. Sometimes you choke and someone gives you the Heimlich maneuver and saves your butt. Obviously, Thoth Witchcraft patrons, kind of our job to do that on certain occasions. We're mentors, after all, what we do, step in if things get too fucking bad. Or you just choke on it, right? But when it comes to magical practices, it's not safe. Magical practice isn't safe. There are ways that you can make things safe. And what you have to remember, the safer you are, very often the slower you will progress to the point which, like on the motorway, you need to be traveling a certain amount of miles per hour, otherwise the police will come along and say you're going too fucking slow. That does happen. I saw that happen to someone once. They were driving too slow on the motorway. I mean, come on, too slow on the motorway, whatever. But basically, that doesn't mean that running around and doing stupid crap and biting off everything. No, because that's probably going to lead to you shoveling too much in your mouth and choking and dying. Okay, if we're using the kind of choking on food example. But there is a balance, yes. And you need to think, well, can I do a little bit more? Within our personal training, when I did the personal training course, we were taught the RPE scale, the rate of perceived exertion. And we were always supposed to train clients, not supposed to train them to 10 out of 10, because 10 out of 10 means they're dying. Okay, you'd normally train them to 7 to 8 out of 10. 5 out of 10, they're sweating, right? They're doing a little bit of exercise. Actually, what you need to do is get them close to doing their maximum, but never get to their maximum. Because as I can attest to, the amount of times I've been pushed to a 10 out of 10 and I've passed out, it's not so healthy, not a good idea. When it comes to magic, I believe the same. I believe that you might not on every practice do a 7 or 8 out of 10. You might be doing stuff that's far, kind of easy. When I do this Philosopher's Stone thing, it ain't gonna push me. That's gonna be like a 2 out of 10 for me, you know? I'm doing it anyway though, because it's of interest. Much like I go for 5 minutes on the cardio machine at level 10, which isn't a huge amount, you know? I don't even sweat, but I still do it because I like cross trainer. I don't like running, but I do like the cross trainer, work that out. Anyway, pushing yourselves in magic. Ask yourself how often you push yourself to an 8 out of 10. Really and truly ask yourself. 8 out of 10 is where you're really like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, I think I'm going to die. 10 out of 10 is dying, mind. 9 out of 10, 8 out of 10 is like, I really actually think that I'm going to die any minute now. Realistically, most people don't. But there we go. So the last part, gaze into the crystal ball. And someone did put something in this. Oh no, did I lose the bookmark? Oh crap. I can't believe I lost the bloody bookmark. Someone said something really cool and it was by a Wiccan as well. Maybe that's why I removed the bookmark. Let's see if I can find it. But no, it was something that I kind of agreed with, but then I thought about it and I thought, no, it really does. I really don't agree with it. I think it was Maxine Sanders said it, because like I said, there are several interviews or like parts in this book. Deary me. It's not even in the bloody, at the end. Oh, how annoying. Risks of magical path. I'm going to have to do my best to paraphrase. But essentially, there was an interview in here with someone called Maxine Sanders, who was basically witch queen of the Alexandrian tradition. She basically said something along the lines of, magical practitioners, when Wicca started, 1950s, going up to kind of 70s and that, they were all kind of beautiful, all kind of, most of them weren't, but let's be fair. She might have a different idea of what beautiful is. They're all very different people. So, you know, it was all kind of like very serious. And then when it got to the 80s and the 90s and that, it all just descended in a pile of crap. I'd agree with that. One thing that I disagree with is what she said was that they used to pick, when they first started the Alexandrian tradition, the creme de la creme. And they used to ignore the rest. And I disagree with that because I think that everyone should be given a chance. And there are many people that we actually have on the Patreon that other people do not feel they deserve the chance because they show none of this natural witchcraft pure talent. Okay. And I can tell you from, I've mentored many a people that have been rejected by occult lodges, that have been told that they're not good enough or that don't see and hear and speak or communicate with spirits and all that general crap. And it doesn't matter, you can still proceed down a magical path. And do you know what? With the right help, you can be a lot of these so-saying naturals, okay? Does it mean that you're gonna be the best witch in the history of the universe or the world? No, maybe not, maybe you will. Ultimately, it doesn't matter. But one thing I can tell you and guarantee is that you will be smarter, stronger, more powerful, and more knowledgeable than you were yesterday. So what do you want? Do you wanna get better? Or do you want to stay yourself? The answer is up to you, obviously. I can't tell you, because if I was to say it, I'd say, you better start getting and doing some magic, because we want you to be a strong practitioner. But that's not for everyone. But anyway, I hope this you liked this book thingy, whatever we're calling this. This is not a book review, and was not a book review. It's Mad Ramblings with me. So there we go. I'll do another one of these. In fact, I think I'm doing these up until the next season of Feisty Witches. So, goodbye, everyone.